How are you guys? Good. You can come closer. Do you guys know what this week is?
4th of July.
4th of July?
What's another name for it?
Independence Day.
Good job. Well, since we're about to celebrate Independence Day here in America, we're going to talk about what it means to be free. If you're independent, what does that mean?
You're free?
Exactly. Every July 4th, the United States celebrates Independence Day. It's the anniversary of when we adopted the Declaration of Independence in 1776. Have you guys heard about that? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Before the Declaration, the people who lived here were ruled by another country across the ocean. In 1776, the people said, "We're free." They said, "We're independent. We have our own country." But did you know that if you believe in Jesus, you have an even better Independence Day? Did you know that? No? In the Bible, 2 Corinthians 3:17 says, "Now the Lord Jesus is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom." So when we ask Jesus to forgive the bad things that we've done, Jesus forgives us. We're free. So when you see flags or fireworks or parades celebrating the United States Independence Day, remember that you have the best freedom of all. Where Jesus is, there is freedom. Should we pray? You can just pray with me, okay? Dear God, please hear us as we silently tell you the bad things we've done. Thanks for the freedom of forgiveness. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And Bonnie's going to read to us from the Gospel of Matthew this morning.
Now when the human one comes in his majesty, and all his angels are with him, he will sit on his majestic throne. All the nations will be gathered in front of him. He will separate them from each other, just as shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right side, but the goats will be put on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who will receive good things from my Father. Inherit the kingdom that was prepared for you before the world began. I was hungry, and you gave me food to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothes to wear. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me." Then those who are righteous will reply to him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you a drink? When did we see you as a stranger and welcome you, or naked and give you clothes to wear? When did we see you sick or in prison and visit you?" Then the king will reply to them, "I assure you that when you have done it for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you have done it for me." So ends the reading of God's holy word.
You know, it's been said frequently, actually, that if you remember the decades of the 60s and 70s, then you weren't really there. Not necessarily when you ask people of that era what they would like to be when they grow up, or what they would like to do for a living when they grow up. I remember well because I was part of that era, and I do remember the 60s and 70s, although bits of it are black. But if you ask somebody what they wanted to be when they grew up, or what they would like to do, quite often the answer would be, "Well, I just want to be happy. I want to be happy in the future." Which probably did not indicate a strong grasp of the future. It was not something that you wanted to answer during an interview question that way, saying that I just want to be happy. And so people didn't really have that strong desire, know exactly what they wanted, but We laugh at that answer sometimes, but it also indicated something about their situation. That situation was that I think a lot of young people at that time saw an unhappiness or saw something that wasn't quite right in their own parents. They saw something that said, boy, I don't want to end up that way. And that's kind of sad when you think about it. But let me introduce you to somebody. This is, I'd like for you to meet Mr. Matthew Ricard. Matthew Ricard is a brilliant individual. He's got a PhD in molecular genetics. He's a poet. He's a philosopher. He's an author. He's also a French interpreter. And he is also a very devout Buddhist monk. And so you can look at this guy and look at his credentials and say, wow, this guy is really intelligent. This guy is very smart. He's got a lot going on. But there's something that you don't see just by looking at him, and that is the inner workings of his brain. Mr. Ricard is 66 years old, and Mr. Ricard has been determined to be the happiest person in the world today. He's always got a bit of a smile on his face. But in 2004, researchers at the University of Wisconsin put 250-some probes on his head and measured his brain activity. And through meditation, he is able to control 95% of the left side of his brain. The left side of your brain is where you control happiness. He's also able to control the right side of his brain, which is the part of the brain that's responsible for negativity. And so what he does is takes every external stimulus that he gets everywhere, from everything, controls 95% of it, and chooses to be happy about it. Therefore, it's been determined that he is the happiest man in the world because he can control that. He doesn't let the negativities come in. We've heard it before. It doesn't really matter what happens to you. What matters is how you react to it. What matters is somebody can't make you angry. You let them make you angry. You give them permission to do those things. And so Mr. Ricard is the happiest man in the world. Wouldn't that be nice to have that claim? Well, Mr. Ricard was interviewed and was asked, what do we need to do to be happy? What do we need to do to have a very fulfilled life? To live life being fulfilled. Now, fulfilled is an interesting word. It's two syllables, very simple, but very hard to accomplish. To have that sense of contentment, that sense of inner self well-being, that you are fulfilled, that you're enjoying every moment of every day that goes on. How do we get that? He identified four areas that we have control over, that we can incorporate in our daily activity that will give us that fulfilled life. And number one is, we've talked about it before, it's that God-given time. It's that time where you go, man, where did the time go? I've been having so much fun, I don't recognize the passage of time. It's called Kairos time. Kairos time is that time that you just don't measure. All of a sudden you say, boy, I've been having such a great time. Look what time it is, where'd it go? That's very special moment time. And if we can savor those moments, if we can actually seek them out and try to live them every day and try to be in that state where we're not paying attention to the chronological passage of time. It's been called extended instance. Extended instance, suspension of time. It's when all this time goes by in just a small fraction. We don't notice it. Savor those, recognize those, go after them. Try to live them. It's God-given time. Number two, the next step to fulfillment is something that may sound trite, may sound trivial, something that we talk about quite often, quite a lot, and that is simply count your blessings. We all have blessings. We all know that we have blessings. And if we don't take that conscious, content time to analyze what's good in our lives and then dwell on what's good in our lives, counting blessings is not a trivial thing. Counting blessings is an extremely important part of being fulfilled, of having a fulfilled life, of living in happiness. Think about what's good in your life, even when it's really, really hard to do. Sometimes we can go through situations where, oh, it's a terrible thing, the loss of a job, the loss of a spouse, something that's awful in our life. And we go through it, and we try to get through, and we say, you know, I'll make it through this. I know that through time I'll heal, I'll feel better about it. And then we do. We get through that, and we look back, and we go, you know, that wasn't quite so bad. In fact, when it did happen, I know at the time I was miserable, but looking back on it, it was actually one of the best things that's ever happened to me. Had this not happened then, I wouldn't be here today. So those are times to count blessings, even when it's dark and gray, even when we know that we're just not happy right now. If we can pull ourselves away from that and think about what's good in our life, we can live and move towards that fulfilled life. The third principle relates to the song that we sang, or that we listened to anyway, earlier this morning. It's about making every moment of our lives, making every day, everything that happens to us, making it an adventure. How do we look at something that's ahead of us, a task, and instead of going through it with drudgery and going through it with negativity, let's look at it as a positive thing. And how do we go through that thing and make it an adventure? Make it fun, something that we enjoy. Now, as we look at our movie clip this morning, we start off with little Russell is talking to Carl as they're walking along with the house that's behind him, and it's the house, of course, is being held up by balloons. I apologize for last week. We didn't have the clip, but this week we've got the clip, so they are close to a place that they wanted to get to. Carl and Russell wanted to get to this place. They're close to it, and they have just a few more, about a mile or so to go, and they're pulling the house that's on the balloons behind them. And they're walking along, and it's a quiet moment, and Russell is explaining to Carl what's important to him, what's an adventure, what's a good time to him. So we start off with that, and then we look at the rest of the clips, and we see the adventures that's ahead of them. So if we could show the first clip there this morning. Thank you.
You know what, Mr. Fredrickson? The wilderness isn't quite what I expected.
Yeah? How so?
It's kind of wild. I mean, it's not how they made it sound in my book.
Get used to that, kid.
My dad made it sound so easy. He's really good at camping and how to make fire from rocks and stuff. He used to come to all my sweat lodge meetings. And afterwards, we'd go get ice cream at Fenton's. I always get chocolate and he gets butterbrickle. Then we sit on this one curb right outside, and I'll count all the blue cars and he counts all the red ones. And whoever gets the most wins. I like that curb. That might sound boring, but I think the boring stuff is the stuff I remember the most. Here. I don't want this anymore.
All this time, Carl was living in regret since Ellie passed away. Living in regret because he felt that he stood in the way of Ellie living out her adventure, of Ellie living out her dreams in life. That portion of the scrapbook that said, "Stuff I'm going to do," Carl had never looked at before. And here it was, Ellie's whole adventure was spending time with Carl. And he didn't know that. And so he was living with this regret and this sadness because he felt he stood in the way of Ellie's adventure. And he didn't. And right there at the end, Ellie is saying, "I've done this. I've had my time. I've looked at it as an adventure. Go and have your own adventure." And so what happens from there is that they move forward and they, Russell and Carl get back together, and Russell and Carl take on some challenges and adversary in life and make their own adventure. They look at every day as an adventure. And they're full of excitement. So Mr. Ricard says, make every day, turn the ordinary into joy. Look at everything as an opportunity and with enthusiasm. Now, people sometimes say, well, can you really do this in life? Does that really happen? Well, there's a gentleman by the name of Larry Walters. On July the 2nd, 1982, was bored one afternoon. Literally, he was bored. And, you know, he's sitting in his lawn chair and he goes, "You know, I've always wanted to fly, but I've never flown. I'd like to try it sometime." So what does he do? The guy goes out and buys 45 weather balloons and attaches each of those weather balloons to his lawn chair. And he fills the weather balloons with helium, just like the movie Up. Boy, this is 1982. Fills them with helium, and he takes with him a parachute, which is not a bad idea, and a pellet gun. Now, the pellet gun is his device for lowering himself. Okay? When he gets up so high, he's going to shoot a balloon out, and that'll bring him down. So he's all ready to go. He's sitting in his lawn chair. He's got his guy wires all tied up. And he says, it's time to go. So he cuts the wire, hoping to get to 300 feet. He thought he could look around and see what was out there, take some pictures, feel good about it. He immediately goes to 16,000 feet. And on the way up, he dropped his pellet gun. He has no way to get down. Jets are flying by, reporting something in the air. There's a guy in the lawn chair. What was he thinking? Well, eventually, he passed out a couple of times. But eventually, the helium left the balloons and he came back down. Got into some high-powered wires and all that stuff and got in a whole bunch of trouble. The FAA fined him. But he flew. That was an adventure for him. He wishes now that he had another pellet gun to take with him, but that was his only way to get down, was to shoot these balloons out. He had no idea it would go that high. In 1987, in Italy, there's an 87-year-old man who lost his wife years ago. And then he had one daughter, and that one daughter was living in Afghanistan at the time. So he was all alone in Italy, feeling very lonely. Didn't have an opportunity to count many blessings. So all of a sudden he gets an idea, and he puts an ad in the local paper. He's trying to get himself adopted as a grandfather. So he puts an ad in the paper, says, "Grandfather, willing to be adopted? We'll look at any family. Please take me in. I'll be a grandparent to one of your kids or to your children." He got responses from all over the world. It was a huge success. And finally, he decided on a family of four. He moved in with them and became their grandfather and lived with them. Angelo somebody. I can't pronounce his last name. But that's taking every day and looking at ordinary things and making them into an opportunity. These people are creative. There's no reason that we can't do the same. Every day is an adventure. Did you notice that Russell, in the beginning, was talking about the times that he spent with his father? sitting on the curb, eating an ice cream cone and counting blue cars and red cars. And whoever had the most cars at the end won. I guess it's the boring times that I remember the most, he said. Special times. Those were times that were extended instants. Those were suspended times that he had where time went by and he didn't even know it by sitting on the curb. We have the opportunity to make those a joyous time. Finally, the fourth thing that Mr. Ricard says that we need to do, that we can concentrate on, that we can make us have a, or help us to have a fulfilled life and can make us happy, it's something that we don't think about very much. We talk about it a lot. We actually pray about it a lot. But I know that you're a lot like me and we don't really feel it a lot. But before anything else that we can do in our lives, the last thing that he says that we can do that will help us live a fulfilled life is to learn how to accept forgiveness. That's a hard thing to do. Some people say, well, if you're going to learn how to live a fulfilled life, learn how to forgive. If you forgive people, that will eliminate the anger and the hurt that you feel if you forgive them. That's why we forgive, is for us. So if we can eliminate that, won't that help us live a fulfilled life? Yes, it will, but if we don't learn how to accept forgiveness first, we can't forgive anybody. We all have made those mistakes in the past. We all have those things that we regret, those guilt trips, those things that, gosh, we wish we could go back in time and not do again, that we could correct, make right. We hang on to them sometimes. And quite frankly, sometimes I think it feels good to hang on to them. That pity party sometimes is fun to be at. But you need to shake that. You need to accept forgiveness. God has forgiven you. We need to forgive ourselves. If we don't accept forgiveness, we can't forgive anybody else. If we don't realize that the past is the past and there's nothing we can do about it, and that God has forgiven us because we've asked Him to, then we can move forward. It's a simple thing to accept forgiveness, but a very hard thing to do. We tend to hang on to it. And the more we try to find the opportunities in life, the more we try to accept forgiveness, the more we try to seek out those moments in time where time doesn't exist, the harder it becomes. And quite often, what happens the most often is that we quit. We give up. We say it's too hard. We look at our lumps and our bumps, and we give up. We give up on that opportunity to live that fulfilled life. I'm reminded of a Simon and Garfunkel song. Do you remember it? Called The Boxer. And it's a story about a young boy who goes to New York City trying to make it in life and doesn't. He seeks out the areas of poverty and where the people that are beaten up and lonely go, the gutter of life. That's where he ends up. And just about when he's ready to give up, in the clearing stands a boxer, a fighter by his trade. And just when the boxer says, "I'm going home, I've given up," the fighter still remains. We fight the good fight. We hang in there. We don't give up. We pay attention to the four things that we know that would give us a fulfilled life. We never, ever give up on that. Paul says in Romans, fight the good fight. And he knows that when it's all over and when it's done, that he has his comfort knowing that he's fought the good fight and that he's hung in there. That he didn't give up. Calvary, did Christ want to give up? You bet he did. Did Christ want to say, "I'm out of here. I don't want this anymore"? Yes, he really wanted to do that. But did he quit? No, he didn't quit. He hung in there. Until his final words, when he said, "It is finished." It was time. It was time to be finished. And that's all that God asks of us. From our scripture today, we learn that if we seek out the least, the lost, those that need us the most, we can provide for them. And that will help us, because Christ will say, when you've done it for them, you've done it for me. Amen.